All right, if the military takes over from President Mubarak, is there really any difference? Joining me now to discuss this, former CIA bin Laden hunter and author of the hot new biography that you can't put down with the very simple name, Osama bin Laden, Michael Scheuer is here. Michael, it's a pleasure. Welcome back to Freedom Watch.
Thank you, Judge.
So earlier today, after a day of buildup, after the crowds getting larger, after leaked information and inconsistent statements coming out of the Egyptian government, the president of Egypt gave a speech that nobody understood, except he basically said, I'm aligned with the martyrs of history, and I'm going to stay in office. I might give a little bit of power to my vice president, but I'm going to stay in power. What do you make of it, and what do you think will happen next?
Well, the President Mubarak clearly got his back up over the intervention of the United States and the West in Egyptian affairs. And the real key occurred yesterday, Judge, when King Abdullah of Saudi Arabia stepped forward and said that he'll replace the American aid if the Americans pull it. So, you know, the wages of interventionism are always very steep. And now we're in a position where the United States has virtually no influence, has angered both sides, and really has helped to create a disaster for the Egyptian economy.
What is your take on the position of the army? As we speak, are there tanks around the presidential palace to keep the crowds out, or are there tanks around the presidential palace to keep a weakened Mubarak in? Or stated differently, is he still the commander-in-chief?
Oh, I think he is. He appealed directly to nationalism here, Judge, in his speech. The army, after all, is still intended to make the country viable. And each day this goes on, Egypt sinks further into an economic morass that I don't know who's going to pay to get them out of it. This is really, you know, democracy, Judge, isn't a game.
Right.
We've spent 800 years building our democracy since Runnymede. And to watch the BBC and the London Guardian and the Washington Post and the New York Times cheer on these people as if they were going to have a democracy overnight has just been a really disgusting experience.
I know, but Mike, a lot of us thought and hoped that a liberal Democrat, lowercase L, lowercase D, might replace President Mubarak, that there might be freedom of speech, that there might be freedom of association, that there might be freedom of religion. Is that a fruitless or fanciful hope?
Well, Judge, you know, with all respect, historically, why would a people like the Egyptians, who are now in the midst of turmoil, violence, and maybe more violence, reach for an alien ideology like secular democracy instead of reaching for what they've known for the past 1,000 years, which is Islam?
All right, what do you expect will happen next? I mean, he said he's going to give some power to Suleiman. Suleiman is the head of the intelligence services. You know him personally from when you were in the Middle East and your career in the CIA. Where do you see this going? Can he stay in office until September? Will he really give some power to the vice president? Will the crowds in the streets accept this?
Well, I worked with his officer, sir. I didn't work with him directly, but they're very loyal. They're very interested in Egypt maintaining its nation state status and not devolving into chaos. I think there's a good chance he'll be there. And frankly, for U.S. interests, the best thing that could happen is for him to be there.
All right. Mike, I know you made some personal sacrifices to be with us tonight, and we appreciate it very much. As always, you're welcome here. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you, Judge.
The revolution in Egypt, the global fallout, former United States Ambassador to the UN, John Bolton, with his take on this after this. My next guest has been following the revolution in Egypt very closely since day one, maybe because he's indicated that he may run for president next year. He may have to deal with whatever government is eventually running that nation. Here now, former U.S. Ambassador to the United Nations and one of the smartest foreign policy minds in the country, John Bolton. Ambassador, welcome back to Freedom Watch.
Glad to be with you.
Were you sort of surprised or let down, as I was and the rest of us were, as we watched this build up and waited for that speech, and we heard 14 minutes of gibberish and nonsense, and then sort of, I'm going to stay in power and probably give some of my authority to my vice president, and I'll let you know later what I'm going to give to him?
Well, I think it's a lesson in not listening to the Western media try and explain what's going on in Egypt. I think this is another example where Mubarak thinks he's given something up by delegating power to Omar Suleiman, and that that's all there is to it. And one thing I would stress, and I think it's important to understand, is I believe that decision was endorsed, shared, discussed by the Egyptian military, at least at the top levels. I don't think there's a split between Mubarak and Suleiman on the one hand and the military on the other.
All right, John, do you think that that decision was endorsed, approved, and discussed with the White House or with the State Department or with any high-ranking authorities in the American government?
My guess is that it was discussed through military channels, but I read Mubarak very plainly to be saying to President Obama, get out of my face and stop trying to push me out of office. He didn't mention him by name, but he talked about foreign influence. And what this shows is even if you agree with the proposition that we should be trying to force Mubarak out, the way Obama's handled it, saying, you know, begin the transition now means yesterday, can have exactly the opposite effect what you want, that it has caused Mubarak to dig in further.
Our colleague, Michael Scheuer, formerly of the CIA, has suggested that the White House has handled this so poorly that it now has made enemies of both sides. The crowds in the streets don't like the White House because they know some of the guns that were pointed at them last week were paid for with American dollars. They also believe that the American government did not push him out. And he, President Mubarak, has stiffened his spine because he thinks the American government did try to push him out. Did the White House drop the ball?
Well, I think they've behaved in an erratic, inconsistent, contradictory fashion, and I think it has left the United States even weaker after these 17 days than going in. Look, whatever your view on how to handle the demonstrations and the future of the regime, there's a lot at stake for America. The information is inadequate, and what that should counsel at a minimum is keep quiet publicly and say as little as possible. Do what you're going to try and do behind the scenes. This administration apparently can't stop talking because, as in domestic policy, too often it views giving a speech as the same as running the executive branch of the government, and the two are widely far apart.
All right. We have reports that there are tanks around the presidential palace. Are they aiming in to confine the president, or are they aiming out to protect him and keep the crowds away?
Well, I don't profess to have any inside information here, but I do think Mubarak has, as he has done through his 30-year rule, consulted with the military, and he at least thinks he has their support. It may not be sustainable. His position may not be sustainable. He may still be gone tomorrow if the demonstrators continue. But I think it's a mistake to believe that Mubarak is operating independently of the military. He believes, in my view, he believes he has their support.
Will the crowds accept Omar Suleiman either as the true lawful successor to President Mubarak or as sort of his handpicked recipient of his authority?
I think the answer is that some will and some won't. But let's be clear, the military has believed for some time that the demonstrators should have been dispersing beginning 10 to 12 days ago. Now, they've avoided the use of physical violence against the demonstrators. I think that's important. Honestly, I think the United States can take some credit for that through the military-to-military communications we've had. But let's also be clear, the Egyptian economy is tanking. Its tourist revenues have dried up. Foreign direct investment has stopped. If they don't get order restored one way or another soon, the economy is just going to make it worse for all Egyptians.
We only have about a minute left. Ambassador Bolton, who's worried by what happened tonight? Is Jordan wondering and worrying if they're next? Is Israel wondering and worrying that the new government in Egypt might not honor the peace treaty? Who's not sleeping well tonight in the Middle East because of events today in Cairo?
Well, it's the $64 question. I don't think anybody's sleeping well in the Middle East tonight. America has enormous strategic interest in the stability of the Egyptian-Israeli peace agreement, the stability of the Jordanian-Israeli peace agreement, the only two states that have made peace with Israel. We've got an interest in oil and natural gas being pumped out of that region. So that's one of the reasons that that events in Egypt are of direct importance to average American citizens. This is not some faraway event that we have no stake in. We have huge interest here.
Ambassador Bolton, thanks very much for joining us.
Thank you.
We'll have much more on the rebellion in Egypt, but we also have a rebellion here in America within the Republican Party. Next.